Blog Talk Radio.
Deeper Truth Radio presents The William Hemsworth Show. If you'd like to be on the show, the number is 646-595-2071. Again, 646-595-2071.
I believe it.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, here's our show host, William Hemsworth.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the program. Powerful word. I believe. Powerful. Reflect on the creed. Reflect on those ancient words which summarize our faith. That'd be a form of prayer. And speaking of prayer, I hope everyone's Lent is going well. And if you've messed up, don't beat yourself up over it. There's still time. There's still more time in Lent. Pick yourself up, dust yourself off. Let's get back in the game. All right? So get back in the game. Let's finish strong. Easter is about a month away, if you can believe it. I mean, time flies when you're having fun, right? Well, everyone, today I wanted to talk about something important, as a lot of things that we talk about here on Deeper Truth Radio are. Well, all things here on Deeper Truth Radio are, because we're talking about the truth, our Catholic faith. But today I wanted to discuss apostolic succession. Now, not just apostolic succession, but I want to discuss apostolic succession's role in the Arian controversy in the 4th century. Now, as some of you may know, St. Athanasius was a key figure during this period, because one of the key things that happened during this whole thing was the Council of Nicaea was called in 325. And so we'll get into that. But to get the true story, not the true story, but the whole story, we have to go back a little more. But before we do that, I want to discuss Pope Benedict XVI, specifically from his book, God's Word, Scripture, Tradition, and Office, which was published back in 2008. That's a great book. I recommend you check it out if you get a chance. But he says a lot about apostolic succession. So apostolic succession is much more than one taking an office from a predecessor. Now, don't get me wrong. That's definitely a big part of it. And as I've mentioned a couple times on this program already, not today's but in previous weeks, in combating the Gnostics, St. Irenaeus listed apostolic succession as a reason for what the true church is. Because he boasted that each bishop lineage back to the apostles. Now, in the early days of the church, succession and tradition were kind of synonymous. They were like terms. They were used with the Greek word diadokoi, and which means to teach. A tradition involves teaching. But again, it's much more than that. So that's what we really want to nail down here before we go into the history of the Arian controversy. See, tradition is forever linked to the person from whom that teaching derives. And here, Pope Benedict XVI writes in that book I mentioned that tradition is linked to a person, is a living word that has its concrete reality in faith. Succession is proclaiming something that has been entrusted to someone by Christ himself. So in apostolic succession, the lineage is not mutually exclusive from the teaching. Those two go hand in hand. Now, throughout the Arian controversy and some modern variations, which we will also go over, there was a deviation from what was taught in the beginning. Apostolic succession is holding fast to the apostolic word, just as tradition means the continuing existence of authorized witnesses. So apostolic succession and apostolic tradition assist in defining each other. The succession is part of the tradition, is a form of the tradition, and the tradition is the content of the succession. Now that we have that cleared up, let's go into the main topic, Arianism. Now, if you follow my blog at all, I write a lot about Arianism. I just had an article dropped this week that mentions some of what we're going to talk about tonight. But to those who study church history, the Arians are a familiar foe to Orthodoxy. Constantinople in 381. Now, how was the view of Christ properly withheld? Was it strictly from St. Athanasius' brilliant exposition of Scripture? Now, don't get me wrong. It was brilliant what he did with Scripture, and that's part of the equation. But Arius was also pleading his case from sacred Scripture. Now, by all accounts, Arius was a brilliant orator. He was able to get crowds riled up into a frenzy. He was a charismatic individual who was also able to coat his words with just a little bit of truth, a shadow of orthodoxy, to get some bishops to agree with his opinion. Now, so who was Arius? What was he talking about here? Of course, we're going to talk about that as well. But again, the most interesting way, most interesting we're going to talk about tonight is how the heresy was thwarted. Now, St. Athanasius gets a lot of credit, and he deserves to get a lot of credit, because he was championing, he was sticking up for orthodoxy against the false view of Christ that Arius was teaching. He did use Scripture, but the thing was that the canon of Scripture had not been formally declared until the Council of Rome in 382. And this happened in 325. So again, we have that tradition playing in what is Scripture. Now, the unsung hero during the whole Arian controversy of the 4th century, as you can guess by what I've already talked about, is apostolic succession and the teaching authority that springs from it. So what is Arianism? So let's talk about that first. Arianism is a heresy that became popular in the 4th century. It's tempting to say that Arianism was a denial of the full divinity of Christ. Now, I want to dig a little deeper, though. Now, this deeper exploration will help us in understanding not only the nature of this heresy, but the role that apostolic succession played in getting it condemned. Now, the beginning of the controversy, we could trace it back a little earlier to some of the earlier church fathers, St. Justin, St. Clement of Alexandria, and Origen, among others. That's because during this time, the church was still asking questions about who Jesus was. And Origen were denying the divinity of Christ. But it kind of has to do with the idea of the Logos. Okay, the Greek philosophers saw God as immutable, and the philosophers were told that Christians believed in such a God. So Logos was the divine reason uttered as the divine word for the sake of forming and governing the world. Now, at least that's the understanding that Stoics and Plotinus had, because that's not the Orthodox teaching. That's not what the church teaches about that. And so you had that going on. Greek philosophy was getting popular, and there were some Greek philosophical terms being used by the church fathers. And some Christians began to say that the Father was impersonal, while the Son, or the Logos, was capable of having human relationships. Now, this is all hard for a pagan people to understand. If we have issues understanding the Trinity, and we've been in the church a while, and Christianity has been around for 2,000 years, imagine the pagan peoples during this time in the early centuries of the church where all this was still being fleshed out. It was hard for them to understand. Now, specifically, it's hard to understand that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit have always existed in unity. It was easier to accept that the Son was somehow subordinate. And this is where Arius enters into the picture. Now, to these pagan converts, Arius made Christ out to be like a type of divine hero, and that was easier for them to understand. Arius was a student of Lucian of Alexandria, and while studying under Lucian, he became friends with a man by the name of Eusebius of Nicomedia. Now, don't get this confused with Eusebius, the great church historian. That's not the same guy. Now, but this Eusebius here that Arius was friends with plays an important role in the in how the Arian heresy got spread. So Arius was a priest who was ordained in Alexandria in 311. Like I said before, he was a charismatic individual who came to openly challenge the doctrine of the Trinity that his bishop, Alexander of Alexandria, was teaching. Many of the locals relayed, they rallied behind Arius because of his persuasiveness as a public speaker. And he used verses such as Proverbs 8:22 to support his doctrine. Now, Proverbs 8:22 says, quote, "The Lord created me at the beginning of his work, the first of his acts of old," end quote. This basis for Arius' argumentation continues through Proverbs 8:31, and it describes the role of wisdom in creation. Since Christ is the Logos, he's God's personified wisdom or reason on earth. Since this passage of Scripture says that he was created, in Arius' mind, this must mean that he's not the same substance as God. If he's not the same substance of God, then he must not be fully divine. Arius said this himself. We do have some of Arius' writings. And this one particular one is in a book called The Emergence of the Catholic Tradition. So it documents this. Give me one moment. I lost my plate. I lost the quote here. I'm trying to find it for you all. So my apologies. All right. So this is what Arius wrote. Before he was begotten or created or ordained or established, he did not exist. Get that? He did not exist. He's talking about Christ. So, in Arius' view, Christ was a created being, and he had the tendencies that created beings have. This meant that he was even liable to change. He was able to change, or even to sin. Now, St. Athanasius sums up the views of Arius very nicely, in my opinion. In his first discourse against the Arians, St. Athanasius writes, quote, "For what can they say from it? But that God was not always a father, but became so afterwards. The Son was not always, for he was not before his generation. He is not from the Father, but he, as others, came into subsistence out of nothing. He is not proper to the Father's essence, for he is a creature and work. And Christ is not very God, but he, as others, was made God by participation. The Son has not exact knowledge of the Father, nor does the Word see the Father perfectly, and neither exactly understands nor knows the Father. He is not the name only called Word and Wisdom, and is called by grace, Son, and power. He is not unalterable, as the Father is, but alterable in nature, as the creatures, and he comes up short of apprehending the perfect knowledge of the Father." And that's St. Athanasius kind of summarizing the views of Arius. Now, the temptation when looking at the Arian controversy is to fast forward and immediately look at the Council of Nicaea. But there's so much more in Nicaea. There's so much more to the church's response than just what happened in Nicaea. Now, as any good pastor would be, Bishop Alexander became concerned by the teaching of one of his priests, Arius. This error has eternal consequences. Eternal consequences for those who become wooed by this new doctrine. Alexander admits that he initially ignored the false doctrines and hoped that they would just kind of go away and die on their own. Plans changed when Bishop Eusebius of Nicomedia came to the aid of Arius. Now, to this, Alexander of Alexandria writes, quote, "But seeing that Eusebius, now of Nicomedia, who thinks that the government of the church rests with him, because retribution has not come upon him for his desertion of Berytus, when he had cast an eye of desire on the church of the Nicodemians, begins to support these apostates and has taken upon him to write letters everywhere on their behalf. If by any means he may draw in certain ignorant persons to the most base and anti-Christian heresy. So Bishop Alexander is calling people who believe in this apostates. In other words, no longer members of Christ's church, and how they're trying to woo others into this anti-Christian heresy. These are strong words in the 4th century. Now, seeing that a fellow bishop is no longer teaching what is part of scripture or sacred tradition, Alexander uses his authority received by apostolic succession to try to correct the situation. Alexander of Alexandria called a local synod that formerly condemned the teachings of Arius, and letters were sent to surrounding bishops to inform them of the synod's conclusion. Now, the way that Alexander pleaded his case against Arius, I don't know, to my opinion, really, was nothing short of brilliant. Like I said before, Arius said that Jesus could not be God because God is immutable. Alexander's argument was polemical in nature, but very effective. He said that Arius denied the immutability of the Father by saying that he was not immutable until the Son was created. So it kind of flipped the script on him a little bit. Now, according to Alexander, and these are Alexander's words, quote, "Now, when Arius and his fellows made these assertions and shamelessly avowed them, we being assembled with the bishops of Egypt and Libya, nearly 100 in number, anathematized both them and their followers." So over 100 bishops exercised their authority that they received by apostolic succession to anathematize Arius and his followers. The teaching that was contrary to the apostles was to risk the salvation of souls. It was dangerous. The early fathers had no choice but to exercise their authority. Now, according to the synod, there was one view of Christ which was handed down directly from the apostles. Unfortunately, this wouldn't be the end of the heresy, or else we'd be done with the show already. Though the synod had pretty much a unanimous ruling, some of the eastern bishops were actually split on this. Remember, because Arius had his words sprinkled with enough truth to make them seem legit. So we look back on this event now and say that this was a serious situation. But a schism this early into the Christian era would have been disastrous. Now, Emperor Constantine heard of the controversy by his bishop named Hosius, H-O-S-I-U-S. Now, according to the ancient church historian Socrates Scholasticus, that church historian writes, quote, "To this end, he sent a letter to Alexander and Arius by a trustworthy person in Hosius, who was bishop of Cordova in Spain, and whom the emperor greatly loved and held in the highest estimation." So Constantine needed Christianity to be unified in a Roman Empire that was already crumbling. Now, to maintain this unity, the emperor called on the bishops in the empire for a council. And this council would become known as the First Ecumenical Council of Nicaea. And because of this council, we say the Nicene Creed every Sunday at Mass. Now, the council commenced in 325 and set a precedent for all other ecumenical councils. The council was so important that all other councils would reference it as being important. The council was made up of 318 bishops. Now, the Pope was absent from the council, okay, not because he wasn't invited, like some people claim, but because he was too elderly to make the trip. Okay, there were no planes or cars in those days. It was a big undertaking to travel. In his place, the Holy Father sent two priests to be legates and to act in his place and authority. Now, church historian William Carroll documents this in his book called man, I'm trying to find it, guys. My computer's freaking out on me a bit tonight. It's called the book is called The Building of Christendom. The Building of Christendom. So he writes in that book, the recommendation for a general or ecumenical council had probably already been made to Constantine by Osius, and most probably to Pope Sylvester as well. Osius presided over its deliberations. He probably, and two priests of Rome certainly, came as representatives of the Pope. Now, championing the Orthodox cause at the council was St. Athanasius. Athanasius was a brilliant theologian who argued from Scripture the case that Christ is eternal. Now, he argued that terms in Scripture such as, was handed over, do not imply that the Son was divine. The Council Fathers rallied behind St. Athanasius because he was preaching the faith that hadn't been, he's preaching the faith that had been handed on onto them. Now, the great saint said many things, but one struck the heart of Arius' argument. Regarding the Logos, Athanasius states, quote, it is plain, therefore, to everyone that not knowing is proper to the flesh, whereas the Logos, insofar as he is the Logos, knows all things, even before their origination. This was a statement of deity that had been passed on from the beginning of the church. Both sides of the controversy appeal to Scripture. I mean, both the Orthodox side coined the usage of the term. The Orthodox side coined the usage of the term that is not in Scripture to describe Christ's deity. It's a Greek word known as homoousios. The term means that the Son is of the same substance or consubstantial as the Father. These are the same words we use at Mass when we recite the Nicene Creed. The teaching was passed on by apostolic succession because that word's not in Scripture and it's passed on. The irony is that while the bishops condemned Arianism, the term itself was a little controversial. The terminology and definitions were defined more narrowly in 381 at the Council of Constantinople, thanks in part to the Cappadocian fathers. And one of them, St. Gregory of Nazianzus, writes, because they are from him, though not after him, being unoriginate necessarily implies being internal, because being eternal does not entail being unoriginate. So, what are some modern forms of Arianism? Now, first and foremost, we have what's known as the Watchtower Bible and Tract Society. Now, they're better known as Jehovah's Witnesses. Now, they believe that Jesus was the Archangel Michael kind of incarnate. So, totally big-time Arianism there. Now, there's other ones, too. So, give me one second here. Again, my computer is freaking out a bit. Anyway, the Jehovah's Witnesses, just like the Arians of old, they believe that Jesus was a created being. Their official doctrinal position is that Jesus is the Archangel Michael and was the first created being. And guys, I got that directly from the Watchtower's website. Now, according to their doctrinal manual, Jesus is the sole direct creation of God. In their view, God created Christ, and Christ created everything else. Now, they're very mission-oriented people, and you've probably had them knock on your door. Though they're going door-to-door to evangelize, that's admirable. But the fact remains that their views of Christ have been condemned throughout the ages. Okay? Now, another one is the Mormons. And I'm sure you probably had them knock on your door as well. So they also teach that Jesus is the Son of God. And they also say that he's fully divine. However, he wasn't always eternal. So you have to be careful the way they use language, because they used language in a way that seems very orthodox, but we're talking two different languages. So when they say that Jesus is God, they're saying that, yes, he's divine, but he's not the same substance as God the Father. And they also believe that Jesus and Satan are actually spiritual brothers. So, just something to think of. Now, according to LDS doctrine, and this is from their gospel manual, their gospel lessons book, that Jesus is the firstborn spirit, Son of God. And Joseph Smith, the founder of the Latter-day Saints Church of Mormonism, says, in his own words, among the spirit children of Elohim, the firstborn was and is Jehovah, or Jesus Christ, in whom all others are juniors. Now, the doctrine of who Christ is, as you can see, differs widely from the historic view of Christianity. Like Arius did in his time, there are certain scriptures that are eisegeted, meaning you're using that one verse to develop a doctrine around while ignoring its context, the other verses around it. You're using that one verse to say what you want to say, basically. And that's what Jehovah's Witnesses do. Actually, Jehovah's Witnesses actually reinterpreted their Bible, the New World Translation, to specifically deny the divinity of Christ. And that's a whole other issue altogether. But the Mormon Church, LDS Church, uses the King James Bible, the Book of Mormon, Doctrine of Covenants, and the Pearl of Great Price as their scriptures. Now, this varies widely from the scriptures that were listed at the Council of Rome in 382. That also listed the Deuterocanon and all those great things, because those books listed at Council of Rome were of apostolic origin. These other ones, like the Book of Mormon, Doctrines, Covenants, Pearl of Great Price, were not. So the concept of Christ in the Mormon Church is vastly different than the Catholic Church. And because of that, we see their baptisms as invalid. Because although they say that they baptize in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, their understanding of who those people are varies so widely from what we believe they are. Now, another form of Arianism some people may find surprising, but that's modernism. Now, it may seem shocking, but when we carry it to its logical conclusion, modernism denies the divinity of Christ. Now, modernism started in the 19th century by elevating human reason to the judge of everything. Human reason is a great gift from God, don't get me wrong. But modernist theologians started denying the inerrancy of Scripture, the virgin birth, the resurrection, and the divinity of Christ. Now, John Shelby, who was an Episcopal bishop and a modernist in his own words, he writes this, quote, "The virgin birth tradition of the New Testament is not literally true. It should not be literally believed." He goes on to say that Christ did not really rise from the dead, and he also questioned his divinity. Now, though modernism is technically defined as a different way of doing things, it's clear that things can get out of hand without a sound authority to guide it. Now, the church in the late 19th and early 20th centuries spent a great deal of time combating modernism. In 1910, St. Pope Pius X, he wrote an encyclical titled The Oath Against the Errors of Modernism. And in that encyclical, he wrote, quote, "Firm faith, I believe that the church, guardian and mistress of the revealed word, was instituted proximately and directly by the true and historical Christ himself, while he sojourned among us, and that the same was built upon Peter, the chief of the apostolic hierarchy, and his successors until the end of time. So that's why apostolic succession is important. Now, like I said at the top of the show, it's very tempting to look at the Arian controversy and think that it was just a thing of the past. But that's an irresponsible perspective from a theological and historical view. The denying of the divinity of Christ is still something that's an issue, and still an issue among those who call themselves Christians. Probably some Catholics in our pews, even. Now, like I said, Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons have a view of Christ that's contrary to Scripture and to sacred tradition. What would Christianity be like if the bishops in Alexandria and Nicaea had not exercised the authority given to them by apostolic succession? It's kind of crazy to think about. The infant church would have already been in schism, a huge schism. The Roman Empire may have possibly collapsed earlier and been thrown into utter chaos even earlier, and that would have been disastrous too. Now, there were men who resisted the temptation. They stayed faithful, and they championed the cause of apostolic teaching, because that's the way that Christ set things up. He established a church with apostolic succession to help guide the flock in the way of the master. As Pope Benedict XVI says in that book that I was talking to you about, he says, quote, "Apostolic succession is by its nature the living presence of the word in the personal form of the witness. The unbroken continuity of witnesses is derived from the nature of the word as authority and oral statement." Well, everyone, I hope that you've enjoyed this episode, learned a little bit about the Arian controversy, a little bit more about church history, and why apostolic succession is important, because it helps preserve truth. I'll leave you with the song, but guys, God bless you. We'll catch you next week. Pray for me as I pray for you. We at Deeper Truth love you, and we thank you for tuning in to all the great programming that's having on. Tune in tomorrow at 9 a.m. for the Rosary. Our world needs prayer, so join us in prayer tomorrow. God bless you all. Have a great night. His holy name.
10,000 years.